Vikram, it's such a pleasure to welcome you here.
Lovely to be here.
You have been a known face throughout the Indian television. But the interesting thing is here at the UC Berkeley, we're talking about AI's influence in and around the industries that you work in. So I'm trying, it'll be a good perspective to get from you. Well, how do you look at it?
As I said out there, it's a very scary thing to do, to come to the University of Berkeley in Silicon Valley and to think as a reporter or a journalist that I can talk about artificial intelligence. I mean, there's so many people here who are way smarter. And, you know, it's in the battle between artificial intelligence and natural stupidity, really a rather stupid thing to do. So I'm just trying to, I was here just trying to give a slightly broader perspective of how the media is looking at the entire field about AI and what the trends are likely to be, and also how AI is going to change the media business itself, because that is one of the areas that I'm doing some work in.
Whenever I get the opportunity to watch you debate, and there are the captains of the industry, there are political leaders and influencers who come on your panels, and India has evolved to a large extent, and India hasn't evolved at all when I hear those discussions going on. What is your take on inspiring the next generation of Indians who are may or may not be so cued in into the political, you know, dialogue that goes on every time, regardless of the affiliation?
I think a lot of Indians are very political. Indians are, they are by nature argumentative, and they are by nature therefore political. You'd be surprised that anywhere you go in India and you start having a conversation, a matter comes to politics. So, cricket, Bollywood, politics, three big, things that are of interest to, I think, most Indians. So, I think there's everything is a glass half full. I think there's a lot of very exciting things that are happening in India. The rate of transformation, there are very few countries of India's size which have been able to grow at 7-8% for 20-30 years, and that's what India is doing. There's no reason to believe it's not going to grow at 7-8% for another 20 years. If that happens, and the transformation that we're going to be seeing in India and Indian society and Indian economy and Indian social circles, everything is going to change. Especially when you layer on that the fact that we are in any case at a global level entering a period of rapid and dramatic technological innovation and advancement. Next 10 years are going to be probably the most exciting 10 years in any of our lifetimes. And that's 10, 15, 20 years. And I think India is going to see a lot of that happen. We just have to hope that some of the negative things and some of the negative throwbacks from the past are not going to come back and hold us back in any way. And that, I think, is an important.
I want to get your perspective on leadership for the young generation. Three aspects. One is the economic or entrepreneurial leadership. One is the political leadership and the social leadership. How do you think we can empower the youth to become better leaders at these three things?
The youth are empowered, politically. Youth can, they have a vote, they can express their views and they do it. And then the youth have a voice far more than they ever did in the past. They can come out and express what they are saying on social media, Facebook, what have you. You're seeing people starting entrepreneurial companies at a much younger age, even in India, not just here. Even in India, you have your kids. I meet kids who are in school and who have built apps to do things like, rape prevention, and alarm. So I think the young are really activated. I do a number of social programs like, Saving the Tiger or, Cleaning Up India. Every time we try and get young people involved, it's dramatic how much energy, how much dynamism and intelligence have been to the entire process. So yeah, I'm a great believer in the power of the young. And to that extent, I do believe India's greatest asset is the fact that they're such a young country.
Okay. Finally, two different perspectives. People from here who has been looking at India 20 years ago, in the last 20 years, and who'll be looking now forward. What do you think India has to offer now, which wasn't there in the past? And the other viewers from the Indian young entrepreneurs, they always look up to Silicon Valley for investment, for advice, for innovation. But they don't have to. There are many other opportunities open for them locally.
Yeah, I mean, I personally am still a great admirer of Silicon Valley. The sort of, we've been here for 2-3 days with AIMA, and I think the sort of companies we've seen and the levels of innovation that you will still see in Silicon Valley are unmatched or unparalleled in any, little geographical area anywhere on the planet. So we can't take that away. And I think for anybody who's interested in innovation, Silicon Valley is almost like a pilgrimage you should make every year just to come and see what is happening. It's a lot that's going on there. Having said that, I think there are other stuff happening elsewhere as well. And I think that sort of a partnership, the ability for people to come back to India and make a profound change is massive. Not many places are going to be growing of that size. how many, you know, $2-3 trillion economies can you think of, which are going to become $10 trillion economies within 10, 15 years or 20 years. It's going to happen in India unless we mess it up. So therefore, the amount of opportunities that there are massive. And so that ability to make that partnership is something which I think is a key focus that we should have, which, by the way, interestingly, was a theme of this entire session. I think it's just the right way to go forward. We should do it often.
I said last question, but this is the last question because I don't get many journalists to interview. What do you think of career in journalism for young Indians now?
I think it's an interesting question, but I think young people need to be prepared for a very different path to the one that they're used to. You know, you became a print journalist. Huh? When I actually studied here at Stanford, and my education was at Oxford, but I came to Stanford to do the Mass Media Institute. And at that time, journalism in India was print journalism. But learning here at Stanford, the Mass Media Institute, I said, no, what I want to do is television. So I went back to India, and it barely existed at that time, television journalism. So I got into that, and I was glad I did it, because it was a wave that I rode. 10 years into it, I said, actually, a next wave is coming, and that next wave was the internet. So I almost moved a lot of my passion has not been so much television as what's been happening on the internet, when I co-founded and sort of founded and built and, you know, built out NDTV.com and the apps and things like that. But that was the next wave. But already when you're looking at it, the other waves that are coming, because it's happening faster and faster and faster. So a kid getting into journalism has to be prepared to say what's going to really work in the next 5 to 10 years or the next 15 years or the next 20 years. It'll be a very different path to, okay, I'm going to go and join the New York Times and I'm going to be working on a desk somewhere, or joining NDTV and working on a desk somewhere. I don't know what they're going to be doing.
Right.
There will be stories to be told and journalistic careers to be built, but it may be very different to anything that my generation did, let alone the generation before that.
Great. Well, such a pleasure. Thank you so much.
Thank you.